Passover to First Communion. And if you have your Bibles, please open with me to Mark chapter 14, verses 12 to 25. If you're taking notes, Mark chapter 14, verses 12 to 25. If you're joining us today for the first time, we've been in a series through the Gospel of Mark, and we were in about maybe the first four or five chapters, but with the beginning of Lent, which started last Sunday, we actually fast-forwarded to chapter 14, and so we're going to kind of walk through Passion Week, and then we'll go back to the early part of Mark after Easter. So please open your Bibles, Mark chapter 4, verses 12 to 25. If you don't have your Bibles, I do have the words up here that I'll go ahead and flip through the slides, and we'll read this together, and then we'll pray and ask God to speak to us this morning. Mark chapter 14, verses 12-25. The Word of God reads, "And on the first day of unleavened bread, when they sacrificed the Passover lamb, Jesus' disciples said to him, 'Where will you have us go and prepare for you to eat the Passover?' And he sent two of his disciples and said to them, 'Go into the city, and a man carrying a jar of water will meet you. Follow him, and wherever he enters, say to the master of the house, "The teacher says, where's my guest room where I may eat the Passover with my disciples?" And he will show you a large upper room furnished and ready. There prepare for us." And the disciples set out and went to the city and found it just as he had told them, and they prepared the Passover. And when it was evening, he came with the 12. And as they were reclining at the table and eating, Jesus said, "Truly I say to you, one of you will betray me, one who is eating with me." They began to be sorrowful and say to him, one after another, "Is it I?" Jesus said to them, "It is one of the 12, one who is dipping bread into the dish with me. For the Son of Man goes as is written of him, but woe to that man by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It would have been better for that man if he had not been born." Verse 22. And as they were eating, he took bread, and after blessing it, broke it and gave it to them and said, "Take, this is my body." And he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, and they all drank of it. And he said to them, "This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many. Truly I say to you, I will not drink again of the fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new in the kingdom of God." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let's pray together before we jump into the word. Our gracious and loving Father, we thank you for bringing us together on this Sunday morning to set this time apart in worship and love, to set this time apart in receiving your word and your grace and your mercies. And Father, we want to pray right now that the power of your Holy Spirit would come upon everyone in this room, and it would give us hearts of good soil to receive your word with hunger and with joy. Father, we pray this morning that we would sense how awesome is this wonderful gift that you have given us, the gift of the Lord's Supper, to remember what Jesus has done for us, to remember his body broken and his blood poured out as a new covenant, a new agreement, a new promise for the forgiveness of our sins, a shedding of blood that would completely get rid of all the animal sacrifices once and for all, because Jesus is the perfect Lamb of God. And we pray this morning that you would speak to us and transform our hearts, that we would live with this wonderful message of the gospel. Father, we thank you for who you are. Speak to us this morning, we pray. In Jesus' name, we lift all these things, and all God's people say, amen, amen. If I were to ask every one of us here this morning, is there a memorable meal, or maybe even the best meal that you've ever had, what would you say? How would you answer that question? What's the most memorable meal that you've had? I've definitely had a few meals like that. I can still remember growing up as an elementary school student, my parents took me out to my first buffet experience. And we went to this restaurant in Naperville called Ponderosa. I don't think this restaurant is around anymore, but I remember going to Ponderosa and having the best fried chicken wings that were always so salty, because I've never been to a buffet before. I remember asking my parents again and again, can I get more? Can I go get more? Because a buffet is you can eat all that you want. I can remember as a junior in high school, 19 years ago, I went to my first missions trip to Oaxaca, Mexico. And I remember this memorable meal where we were served barbecue iguana. And it was served by the locals. We were required to eat all of it, including the skin, which tasted like crispy leather. And I also remember that, we slaughtered a goat. And you can kind of see all the guts to the left. That's all the guts inside that we had taken out. And I slaughtered a goat, and we were asked to eat whatever piece was given to us, and I opened my tinfoil, and I was so glad that it was a piece of thigh and not one of the organs. And I remember one of our teammates got the testicles, and he had to eat the testicles of the goat. But this was a very memorable meal for me. You know, I can also remember when I was back in college at Purdue. When I graduated, the last meal that I had before I left campus with my roommate, who I lived with for 4 years, we cooked this dish often, which was rice, spam, eggs, and rooster sauce. And we ate this about 3-4 times a week, contributing to high cholesterol. But that was the last meal that I had before I left my college campus at Purdue. I remember in 2009, I led my very first missions team to South Dakota, Rosebud Reservation, and being surprised by one of the hosts of a home we were painting with authentic traditional Native American Indian tacos. And I remember just feeling so much love eating this very memorable meal. I remember when I traveled to India the year after in 2010, having the first meal in India, authentic rice and curry, and just tasting the love of the people who prepared this meal for me. You see, meals are a very significant part of our lives, not just for survival, but I think we would all agree that meals are also for building memories and relationships. And if you were to ask that same question to these disciples this morning, to the 12 disciples, what is the most memorable meal that you've had? I think all of them would agree that it was this. It was what we read this morning, the very last meal that they had with their Master and Lord, Jesus Christ. You know, this morning, we are in the final week of Jesus' life, the Passion Week, and this is what everything, really what all of history has been progressing towards. If you look at the four gospel writers, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, they devote quite amount of ink into this last week. Anywhere from a quarter to half of the gospel accounts are spent on these last few days of Jesus' earthly life. And this morning, what we're going to look at is really the calm before the storm, which was Jesus' final meal, a final intimate moment that he shared with his best friends before he's arrested and killed. So as we walk through this passage, we're going to see three movements that Mark highlights. And if you're taking notes, I hope you're taking notes, because there is small group after worship today. We're going to see these three movements as we walk through this passage. Three movements. The first is the preparation of Passover. That's from verses 12 to 16. We're going to see Jesus, he's sending out two of his disciples ahead of him to prepare this Passover meal, and he intentionally aligns these events with this Jewish holiday, this Jewish celebration. The second movement, from the preparation of Passover, we're going to see the prediction of betrayal. And, all four gospel writers, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, they all have different perspectives. When you read all four accounts, Matthew and Mark are very similar. Luke is a little bit different, and John is very different. We're going to look at all of them. But one thing that they all highlight and have in common is a very vivid detail into how Jesus predicted this betrayal. And this moment during this meal was so memorable to the disciples that they all covered it in the Gospels. That's the second movement. And then the third movement, as we kind of close and then participate in communion together, is this wonderful promise of the communion. A wonderful promise of the communion where Jesus, what he does is he transforms the Passover meal into the Lord's Supper and says, this is now a new agreement with my blood, a new covenant, a new promise, introducing a new way that God is going to relate with his people. So let's go ahead and begin. We're going to start with the first movement, which is the preparation of Passover. And let's go ahead and read the very first verse, which is verse 12. Verse 12, it says, on the first day of unleavened bread, when they sacrificed the Passover lamb, Jesus' disciples said to him, where will you have us go and prepare for you to eat the Passover? Now, friends, the Passover has been celebrated for 1,500 years, ever since the time of the Exodus, without a break, every single year. But this moment that we're looking at this morning was going to be the final legitimate Passover. Now, in order to understand the meaning of this holiday meal, we have to go back 1,500 years prior to the very first original Passover, which brings us to the second book of the Old Testament, Exodus. So when you go back to this time, about 1,500 years prior, this is what it looked like. It's the land of Egypt, about 1446 BC at the time of Moses, and the Israelites, or the Hebrews, they had been in Egypt and they were in slavery for 400 years. 400 years they were in slavery. If you've read through the book of Genesis, come to the end of Genesis, and you'll remember that the Israelites, they came down through the life of Joseph, the family of Jacob, and they came down to Egypt, they settled there, and then over the years, the Bible tells us that the Israelites began to multiply, and they grew, and they grew, and they grew, and they grew so much that the Egyptians began to fear them. And the Egyptians began to be overwhelmed by their population. And so what did the Egyptians do? The Bible tells us that the Egyptians enslaved the Hebrews. They enslaved the Israelites for 400 years. And the Egyptians were pressing down so hard on the Israelites, so much so that eventually they began to kill the Hebrew baby boys in order to control the population. So they went to those extremes. I mean, this was an awful, awful, terrible, horrific situation. And so the Hebrews, what do? They began to cry out to God. And they said, God, rescue us. This is too much for us. God, rescue us. God, help us. And what did God do? God did rescue them. And he rescued them by raising up who? Moses. And Moses comes on the scene. Most of us are familiar with this story where Moses comes to Pharaoh and says, Pharaoh, let my people go. Anyone here see the original movie, Ten Commandments? From 1950, if you haven't seen it, you got to rent it, you got to watch it. It's from 1956, but amazing, amazing acting. But Ten Commandments, or Disney's Prince of Egypt, it's been on Hollywood, big screen before. But in this scene, Moses says, let my people go, and Pharaoh says, no. And so God, through Moses, brings judgment upon the Egyptians through a series of plagues. And we all know some of these plagues. There were 10 plagues in total. The Nile River turns to blood. There were frogs. There were lice. There were flies. Livestock getting sick. Boils on the skin. Hail from the sky. There was locust darkness. And over again, Moses says, Pharaoh, let my people go. Pharaoh says, no. And then judgment. Moses says, let my people go. Pharaoh says, no. And then there's judgment. Over and over until the 10th and final judgment, which is where God strikes down the firstborn, sons and even animals, and this is where we get the Passover. You see, the Passover is described in Exodus chapter 12. I'm not going to read that for us, but I'm going to highlight what God instructs Moses to do, and God explains this is what he's going to do. So when you go to Exodus 12, these are the instructions of what happened at that time. Number one, God says that the first month that you're in right now, this month of Nisan is kind of like our March, April, but this month of Nisan is now going to be the first month of your calendar. God says the events that I'm about to bring upon are so significant that I want you to start your year now, and your year is going to be shaped by them. So you're going to start out your year by remembering what I'm going to do right now. And then what else does God say? God says, on the 10th day of the month, which was Monday at this time, I want each household to select an unblemished lamb. And I want you to pick a lamb out of the flock, a lamb that has no spots, no skin disease, nothing, a perfect lamb. And then that's on the 10th day, which is Monday. And then on the 14th day, I want you to slaughter that lamb at twilight. Twilight is about 3 p.m. from between two evenings. Each household was to kill and slaughter that lamb without breaking any of its bones. And then with that lamb's blood, God says, I want you to smear it door frame of your house. Use a hyssop branch, dip it in the blood of that lamb you just slaughtered, and smear it all over the doorpost of your house. And then after you do that, I want you to sit with your family, and I want you to eat that lamb. None of it is supposed to be left over. Eat all of it. Whatever's not eaten, burn it. But eat it with bitter herbs and unleavened bread, each of these symbolizing a different aspect of what you're going through. And then on that night, this is what I'm going to do. God is going to send his angel, the angel of God, is going to come over Egypt, and is going to put to death the firstborn in every household and livestock that was not marked with the blood of the Passover lamb. So this is where we get Passover. Because you see, the angel of God's going to come, and it's going to look, if there's blood, it will pass over that house and go to the next house. And it will go to every single house in all of Egypt and strike down the firstborn child or the firstborn animal not marked with the blood. If you look at Exodus chapter 12, this is what it looked like. At midnight, the Lord struck down all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, from the firstborn of Pharaoh who sat on his throne to the firstborn of the captive who was in the dungeon, and all the firstborn of the livestock. And Pharaoh rose up in the night, he and all his servants and all the Egyptians. And listen to this, there was a great cry in Egypt, for there was not a house where someone was not dead. And then finally, what does God say? God says to Moses that your people are to celebrate this Passover consistently, year after year, at the first month of the year. I want you to remember what I'm doing. You're going to celebrate this Passover with this Passover meal, and it's going to be followed by a week-long festival called the Feast of the Unleavened Bread, and you're going to eat bread with no leaven in it to remind you how you left Egypt in a hurry and how you went through the desert, how you went through the Red Sea where God rescued you. So this is Passover. That was the original Passover. In Exodus chapter 12, it says, when your children say to you, what do you mean by this service? You shall say, it is the sacrifice of the Lord's Passover. For God passed over the houses of the people of Israel in Egypt when he struck the Egyptians, but he spared our houses. And the people bowed their heads and worshiped. So this was a reminder of God's rescue and redemption. Every time you celebrate this Passover, you are to remember how God heard your cries and he rescued you. He took you out of Egypt. But it's also a sign of God's power and punishment, that if you are someone who continues to reject and ignore the works of God, then he will bring his wrath and punishment upon you. This was a very sober celebration as they recognized who God was, and that there would be an appropriate fear of who God was as they celebrated the Passover year after year. And to this day, right now, the Jewish people, they celebrate Passover. And this is what their plate looks like. Every time you celebrate Passover, you've got a piece of lamb on the dish with, you know, a reminder, the roasted lamb, reminder of the Jews putting the blood on the doorposts of Egypt to keep the angel of death from slaying their firstborn. You've got unleavened bread, or the matzah, reminded them of the quickness of God's deliverance. There's also a bowl of salt water that you see up there, kind of picturing the tears that were shed when they were in slavery and in bondage and crossing the Red Sea. There's bitter herbs on the dish as well to speak of their suffering as Pharaoh's slaves. And at some point, there was also four cups of wine diluted with water, and these four cups represented cups of different parts of what they were going through. The cup of plagues, cup of redemption, cup of praise. And so this has been celebrated throughout the century, and this is what Jesus was celebrating right now with his disciples. So as we go back to our passage in Mark, as they're getting ready to celebrate this, what does Jesus say? Jesus says, he sends out two disciples and says, go into the city, and a man carrying a jar of water is going to meet you, and follow him. And wherever this man enters, say to the master of the house, the teacher says, where is my guest room where I may eat the Passover with my disciples? And he will show you a large upper room, furnished and ready, there prepare for us. And the disciples set out, went to the city, and found it just as he had told them, and they prepared the Passover. You know, just 4 days before this moment, it was Palm Sunday. And on Palm Sunday, Sunday, Jesus prearranged a donkey that he used to ride into Jerusalem. Now, when you look at this passage, he's once again prearranged the preparations for this Passover meal. In this moment, it's Thursday night. That's where we are in Passion Week. It's Thursday night of Passion Week. So at this time, Jerusalem would have been crowded. I mean, heavily crowded with hundreds and thousands of families coming to Jerusalem to celebrate Passover. And the disciples, along with Jesus, they needed to find a room to celebrate themselves. But Jesus already worked it all out in advance. But there's something very important that we have to pay attention to as we look at this passage. If you remember from last week, we need to make note that Jesus is aware that Judas is looking out for the perfect opportunity to get Jesus arrested. So when you look at verse 12 up there, notice that when the disciples, they ask Jesus, where should we go to prepare the Passover meal? Judas is probably listening very carefully. Because once he knows where they're going to have it, he can report the location to the authorities and get his money for betraying Jesus. But Jesus knows this, so the Bible tells us what? He sends out two of his disciples, Peter and John, as we look at the other Gospels, and he tells them, go into the city, and a man carrying a jar of water is going to meet you. Now, we have to stop right there. You're going to find a man carrying a jar of water. Now, when they heard this, that's really strange. That's a very interesting detail, because you wouldn't normally find a man carrying a jar of water, because carrying jars of water was usually the work for women. And the two disciples, they're told to meet a man in a crowded city, and this man is going to stick out like a sore thumb because he's carrying a jar of water. So I was thinking about today, it's like, I was going to say maybe it's like a man carrying a woman's purse, but that's not a really uncommon thing today. So maybe today it's like a little boy dressed in a suit with a briefcase. I mean, if you saw a little boy walking around with a briefcase and a suit, he would stick out in a large crowd. The point is, Jesus says you're going to be able to spot him. When you go into the city, it's going to be crowded, but you're going to find a man with a jar of water. And then Jesus says what? Wherever he enters, say to the master of the house, the teacher says, where's my guest room where I might eat the Passover with my disciples? Notice, they don't even say the word Jesus. Just in case somebody's listening, because they don't want anyone to know where this is going to be, you just follow the man with the water jar. Just follow. Wherever the man goes, just follow him. And the man is going to show you a large upper room furnished and ready to go. What did this show us about the man with the jar of water and the master of the house? It shows us that this man was someone who was familiar with Jesus, somebody who knew him, loved him, believed in him. So go find this man, follow him, and he's going to show you a large upper room furnished and ready, and wait for us there. Again, why all this secrecy? Why not just say, Peter, John, meet us over there on Foster Avenue. No, 900 Foster Avenue at 5 p.m., meet us over there. Why couldn't Jesus do that? Because Judas would know, and then Judas would report the location to the authorities, which would then get Jesus arrested earlier than the timeline set by God. You see, Jesus knew that Judas was plotting and planning. And this upper room would have been the perfect place for him to be taken by the temple police. But you see, Jesus was set to die when? It's Thursday night right now. Jesus was set to die on the next day at 3 o'clock p.m. So Jesus has this divine timeline. And so every detail is being intricately planned. And Jesus knew exactly what was going to happen next without speeding up or slowing down the time. When you read John's gospel, Jesus still had a lot to do. When they got to the upper room, Jesus was washing the disciples' feet. He was going to teach the disciples about the Holy Spirit. He's going to give a high priestly prayer in chapter 17 of John. Jesus still had all these things to do. And so he keeps the location a secret. So Judas does not know where they're going to be. I look at this passage and it's just amazing to see everyone doing what they're doing and the Lord moving towards the cross as God directs everything. Isn't that amazing? And we now move and transition into the second movement, which is the Passover meal, and we go into the prediction of betrayal. So look at verses 17 with me. It says, and then when it was evening, he came with the 12. So they don't know where the location is. They're just following Jesus because Jesus knows where it is. The disciples don't know. Peter and John are waiting at the upper room. Everybody arrives at evening. And then as they were reclining at the table and eating, Jesus said, "Truly, I say to you, one of you is going to betray me, one who is eating with me." And they began to be sorrowful and to say to him one after another, "Is it I?" And Jesus said to them, "It is one of the 12, one who is dipping bread into the dish with me. For the Son of Man goes as is written of him, but woe to that man by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It would have been better for that man if he had not been born." This was an intense moment. You can imagine in the middle of this Passover meal where Jesus described the betrayal. And of course, Jesus knew all along who it was going to be. It was going to be Judas. Jesus knew that. He knew Judas. He knew Judas's heart. So this is Mark's recorded event. Matthew records it the same, but Matthew adds one more verse. If you look at Matthew chapter 26, this is what Matthew adds. Matthew says, "Judas, who had betrayed Jesus, answered, 'Is it I, Rabbi?'" So Judas looked directly at Jesus and said, is it me? And Jesus said to Judas, "You have said so." Jesus acknowledges, "Yes, Judas, it's you." I also want to read John's version of this as well, which occurred right after Jesus washed. So Jesus washes their feet. We don't find that in Mark, but it's in John. Jesus washes their feet, and then he gives this conversation. So it's a little bit different, but this is what it says. After saying these things, Jesus was troubled in his spirit and testified, "Truly I say to you, one of you will betray me." And the disciples looked at one another, uncertain of whom he spoke. And one of his disciples, whom Jesus loved, that's John, was reclining at table at Jesus' side. So he was right next to Jesus. So Simon Peter motioned to John and said, "Ask Jesus whom he's speaking of." And so that disciple, which is John, leaning back against Jesus and said to Jesus, "Lord, who is it?" And Jesus answered, "It is he to whom I will give this morsel of bread when I have dipped it." And so when he dipped the morsel, he gave it to Judas, the son of Simon Iscariot. And then after that, he had taken the morsel. Satan entered into Judas. And Jesus said to him, "What you are going to do, do it quickly." Now, no one at the table knew why Jesus said this to him. Some thought that because Judas had the money bag, Jesus was telling him, "Buy what we need for the feast," or that he should give something to the poor. And so after receiving the morsel of bread, Judas immediately went out, and it was night. You know, whenever I think about the Last Supper, this is the first image that comes to mind. We've all seen this, right? Da Vinci's Last Supper. I want you to turn to your neighbor and say, "That's wrong." Yes, that is not what it looked like. Whenever I see this painting, I picture like Jesus saying, "Okay, guys, get on one side of the table. If you want to be in the picture, let's all come to one side of the table." That's not what Jesus was doing. This is not what the table looked like. Because the Bible says they were reclining at the table. Not sitting, they were reclining at the table. I was doing some research at what dining tables look like around this time, and I found a painting of what it probably looked like, probably something more accurate. So this is not the Last Supper. It's not what it looked like. This is probably a little bit more accurate of what it might have looked like, and even the seating arrangement as well. When you look at this painting, this is probably how they ate, around a U-shaped table. Bible says they reclined at the table, which means their heads would have been at the table, their feet reclined away from the table. And they didn't put their feet under the table like we do, but they were reclining, maybe like on a couch or a chair of some kind, on this low-to-the-ground table. And most likely, Judas, as you look at this picture, Judas would have probably been the guy on the lower left, all the way on the lower left. And the reason why it's thought that he might sit there is because traditionally in this setting, the guy who pays for the meal usually sits in that seat. And Judas always had the money bag, so he probably paid for the meal most of the time, so he might have sat there on the bottom left of that U. And traditionally, the guest of honor was usually the second one in from the bottom left. And so when you look at the one right above Judas, it's probably Jesus. And we can assume that John was on the other side of Jesus, next to Jesus, because we read from John's gospel, as I just read, that Peter asked John to lean in on Jesus and ask him. So maybe John was on the other side of Jesus, and maybe Peter was across the table on the bottom right. Perhaps he's the guy over there. So in this arrangement, when you look carefully, the head of John was close to the chest of Jesus. The head of Jesus was close to the chest of Judas. And this must have been the arrangement in order to allow for the dialogue that we just read in the biblical account. So we can imagine this happening. So just kind of picture what's going on. And Jesus says, one of you is going to betray me. And that was outrageous. To say something like that, because back in this culture, to eat with somebody, sit down with somebody, and have a meal with them was the ultimate sign of friendship and loyalty and love and respect. And when Jesus said, it's one who's dipping the bread on the same dish with me, that's the person that's going to betray me. If you think about it, there were only two disciples who could have reached in the same dish that Jesus was using, John and Judas. And yet forever to their credit, these disciples, not one of them, when Jesus said, one of you is going to betray me, none of the disciples said, I know it is. It's him. It's you. It's him. It's Matthew. It's John. It's none of them said that. But instead, each one of them said what? Is it I? Is it I? That's an incredible reaction in that each of these disciples knew in their own hearts. They knew that they were all weak. And they knew that they couldn't trust themselves. And they all start asking, is it I? And there's this commotion and murmuring. And Peter's across the table while everyone asking, is it I? Is it I? Is I? And then Peter looks at John and says, John, ask him. Ask him who it is. Ask him. And so John leans over and asks Jesus, who is it? And Jesus says, it's the one who I give this morsel of bread after I dip it in the cup. And shortly after that, as they're all asking, is it I, is it I? Jesus gives that bread to Judas and says, do what you're going to do quickly. You know, as foolish as Judas was, as much as he operated out of his own evil desires, Judas did not function outside the plan of God. Judas did not change the plan of God. He didn't alter the plan of God. He didn't adjust the plan of God. Why? Because the Bible says in verse 21, for the Son of Man goes as it is written. I find this so amazing that every detail, the detail of the crucifixion in Psalm 22, this betrayal that we're reading about was prophesied in Psalm 55, the meaning of the crucifixion in Isaiah 53, the detail of Jesus being pierced, Zechariah 12, all that we're reading has been pre-written. Everything. And that's why Paul, when he preaches the gospel in 1 Corinthians, what does he say? For I deliver to you as of first importance what I also received, that Christ died for our sins, in accordance with the scriptures. And that he was buried and that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the scripture. Everything was laid out in the Bible. Everything. Even what we're reading about this morning. Jesus was not killed at the plan of Judas or Pilate or Herod or Caiaphas or the Romans or the Sanhedrin or even Satan, but God. It was God's timing and God's plan. Can we hear amen to that? Look at verse 21. Woe to that man by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. Jesus says, woe to him. Not because Judas couldn't help himself, but because he could have helped it. Judas was not driven to betray the Lord. He chose to do it. Let me say that again. He chose to do it. Judas was not a robot forced to do something. Judas was not driven. He chose to do it until the very end. When you look at the gospel accounts, Jesus concealed from the other disciples the identity of his betrayer. He never told his disciples who the betrayer was. Why? He wanted to give Judas every opportunity to turn from sin. Even in John chapter 13, Jesus got that bucket of water and he even washed Judas's feet. Could you imagine that? Jesus knew Judas was going to betray him, that backstabbing brother, but he brings that bucket, and with the same love and affection, he still washes Judas's feet. And even this gracious love did not break Judas's heart. And this is why Jesus adds what are probably the most solemn words that ever fell from his lips. It would have been better for that man if he had not been born. There is no stronger statement in Scripture on human responsibility than this. Judas, like any sinner, any rejecter, has acted on his own motives, on his own choice, on his own will, as a result of his own mental planning and the desires of his own lust. He operated out of his own greed, his own selfishness, his own materialism, and he betrays Christ. Friends, Judas was lost for the same reason millions are lost today. He did not repent of his sins and believe on Jesus Christ. And yet everything Judas does is perfectly fit by God into the chosen part of God's plan, and Judas plays a role. He was responsible for his own decisions, but in doing so, he fulfilled the word of God. In fact, Judas was allowed to be a disciple for that reason. And yet Jesus gave him opportunity after opportunity to believe the truth, but rejection was his choice. Better never born than to be damned forever. So Jesus is saying, he's saying, if you've never been born again as a Christian, one day you'll wish you had never been born at all. Jesus calls out Judas and lets him know that he knows. He knows what Judas is up to. And then Judas leaves and he finishes the betrayal. Friends, over the last 3 years, Judas had been with Jesus day after day after day. If you just look at the book of Mark, just look at Mark alone. When you look at the book of Mark, what did Judas see? In Mark chapter 1, he saw a man possessed by a demon being healed. Judas probably saw this a lot. He saw that there's a spiritual world out there, not just physical, but he saw a spiritual world. And when Jesus came toe-to-toe with evil forces, the evil forces cowered and fled. Judas saw this a lot. In chapter 1, he saw a leper healed and cleansed, an incurable disease. In chapter 2, he saw a paralytic stand up and walk. In chapter 4, he saw an intense storm being calmed by Jesus. In chapter 6, he saw Jesus feeding the 5,000 with just a couple loaves and fish. And then a couple chapter later, in chapter 8, he saw Jesus feed 4,000. Chapter 6, Judas saw Jesus walk on water after joining them on the boat, seeing the storm being calmed. Judas saw all of this, and he still chose to betray Jesus. It's remarkable that you can go through 3 years of that and think, I can still probably get away with this. I could probably overcome this Jesus. I could fix this in a way that it'll work for me and not him. What do we see in Jesus? What we see in Jesus is what we also see in ourselves. We see the ability of a man to reject the power and presence of God due to his own selfish desires. And we need to see that we all here, myself the most, have the heart of Judas. That it's in each one of us. That we are so often blinded by our sin, that we've all witnessed the great works of God. None of us here have seen the 10 plagues. None of us have seen what the disciples have seen. But we have still seen God's power at work. Can we hear amen to that? We've seen the beauty of the creation. If you've been to the Grand Canyon or Yellowstone National Park, if you've seen how beautiful the sky can be on a wonderful day, we have all seen God's power and presence. And yet so often we live our lives and make choices as if Jesus is not watching. We cheat a little on our taxes. We dishonor our parents. We murder one another with angry thoughts and angry words. The Bible says in Romans 1, for his invisible attributes, eternal power, nature, have been clearly perceived since the creation of the world. So they, you and I, are without presence, his power clear in all of our lives. But due to our desire to get stuff, to prosper, we don't see it. And we think we can get away with it. I think this is a really good illustration of what's happening here. It's like a little kid poking at a lion with a stick, thinking that lion is sleeping, thinking that lion is not going to do anything, that lion's not going to respond. And we blindly think that we can just keep on doing what we're doing, that we're probably stronger than the lion, realizing that lion can wake up and show its fierceness at any given moment. But you and I, this is what sin is. We continue to poke. We poke with that stick, just as Pharaoh did. Pharaoh poked at the stick, just as Judas did, and for that reason, we are in need. We are in need because that lion will wake up and the wrath will be poured out, and justifiably so. And we need a new agreement, a new covenant. We need God to do something to protect us from his own wrath. And that is why Jesus initiated a new agreement, which comes to our last point, the promise of communion. Look at verse 22. And as they were eating, Jesus took the bread, and after blessing it, he broke it, he gave it to them, and said, "Take, this is my body." And he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, and they all drank of it. And Jesus said to them, "This is my blood of the covenant, promise, agreement, which is poured out for many. Truly, I say to you, I will not drink again of the fruit of this vine until that day when I drink it new in the kingdom of God." What is happening in these four verses? As we close, Jesus transforms the Passover meal into the Lord's Supper in order to institute a new agreement, a new promise, a new covenant that he was going to have with us. You know, we just read in Mark describing how Jesus took the bread and the cup in the middle of this traditional meal. During the Passover meal, he took the bread, he also took the cup, and he took these symbols that were impressed upon the Jewish culture for 1,500 years. And he said, these elements are actually a foreshadow. It's a picture of what is to come and what I'm about to do. Jesus is saying over all these hundreds of years, the Passover was pointing to the perfect Lamb of God, Jesus Christ, who would take away all the sins of the world. Can we hear amen to that? Look at Luke's account. When the hour came, Jesus reclined at the table and the apostles with him, and he said to them, "I've earnestly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I tell you, I'm not going to eat of it until it's fulfilled in the kingdom of God." And Jesus took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he said, "Take this and divide it among yourselves. For I tell you that from now on, I will not drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes." And Jesus took the bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to them, saying, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And likewise, the cup after they had eaten, saying, "This cup that is poured out for you is the new covenant, the new agreement in my blood." Jesus says, there's a new covenant that's being poured out in my blood. Up until now, you've been celebrating this Passover. You've been remembering how God's wrath was shown through the 10 plagues in Egypt, how the blood of the Passover lamb covered the doorposts of your home, and the angel of God passed over your houses. And Jesus saying, that symbol from 1,500 years ago, I'm telling you, it's a picture of what I'm going to do right now. It's going to be my blood, the new covenant. Now my blood will cover, not your doorpost, but it will cover your hearts. And I'm going to give of myself. I'm going to take the wrath upon myself. That lion that's going to wake up, that lion that's about to wake up and devour you, is suddenly going to see a lamb. And that lamb is going to take that lion's attention away. And Jesus takes the wrath upon himself. That's the gospel message. The wrath that you and I deserve, the Lamb, the perfect Lamb of God, takes it away. Can we hear amen to that? You see, the bread and the wine, they were two common items that were used in just about every meal, and Jesus gave it a practically new meaning. He said, "This is my body, this is my blood." He didn't transform either the bread or the wine into anything different. When the disciples ate the bread, it's still bread. When they drank the wine, it's still wine. It didn't just magically transform into Jesus' blood. However, the Lord gave a new meaning and said, the bread and the wine, from this hour, it's going to be a memorial of my suffering and death. A memorial. And Jesus' command was what? Do this in remembrance of me, in memory of me. So often we think, then when we do something in memory, it's like in memory of somebody who passed away or somebody who died, like in memory of my father, in memory of my grandmother. No, Jesus says, in memory of me, I'm not dead, I'm actually alive today. The word remember here carries the idea of a present participation in a past event. Because Jesus is alive as we celebrate the Lord's Supper today. Can we hear amen to that? And by faith, we have communion with him. So what is the breaking of bread? The breaking of bread is a remembrance of what Jesus did and why he did it. God has given us this wonderful sacrament to remember his suffering, his body broken, blood poured out. So much of the Christian life is about remembering. Yes, it's about living, action, but it's also about remembering because we are people who forget so often. The Lord's Supper is also an acknowledgement of the new covenant. Jesus said, a new covenant in my blood. He's saying, I'm making a new agreement with you that if you follow me, believe unto me, we're going to relate with each other. That wrath is going to be removed and we can now have a true relationship, a true fellowship. It's a proclamation of the Lord's death. So as we take the bread and cup, we are declaring Jesus has died once and for all. It is finished. And the last and fourth thing is an anticipation of the kingdom to come. Jesus says, I'm not going to drink of this until I'm in the kingdom. And with that statement, it was the end of all legitimate Passovers. Jesus ate the lamb, and then he became the lamb for us. Last passage before we participate in the Lord's Supper together. Paul says, whoever eats the bread and drinks the cup in an unworthy manner, do you see that? Will be guilty concerning the body and blood of the Lord. You see, we don't do this casually. Bread, cup, okay, now it's over. Let's go home. Let a person examine himself and so eat the bread and drink of this cup. For anyone who eats and drinks without discerning the body eats and drinks judgment on himself. That is why many of you are weak and ill, and some have died. But if we judged ourselves truly, we would not be judged. But when we are judged by the Lord, we are disciplined so that we may not be condemned along with the world. This is a very serious passage, and it shows us the seriousness of this act of breaking bread. What does Paul urge us? He says, examine ourselves. Take a look at our own hearts for different sin in our lives or things that we need to deal with or bring before God. But also, we need to make sure our minds, our hearts, our thoughts are here, that we would picture Christ, that we would sit at the table with him and picture Jesus looking at every one of us face to face and saying, this is my body broken for you. This is my blood shed for you. That we would all be able to picture that and fix our minds and understand what Jesus did, that when we break bread, we are acknowledging something incredible that God was preparing all throughout history. Amen? Jesus is the Passover lamb. He became the perfect lamb. And by going to the cross, Jesus got rid of the whole animal sacrificial system. It was done. Could you imagine how many lambs were killed over 1,500 years? Once and for all, it was done. Because Jesus was the perfect Lamb of God. That's why we sing, the perfect Lamb of God who took away all the sins of the world. Amen? Let's bow together in prayer as you prepare to take communion. Thanks be to God. Jesus says, this cup represents the blood that I'm about to pour and shed, and it's a new covenant. It is a new promise. And let me share with all of you this morning what that promise is. That promise is a promise of forgiveness. it's a promise of salvation, a promise of new life. It's a promise that says no matter where you've been, no matter what you've done, no matter how many sins you've committed, no matter how far you feel from God, His love is great, His love is wide, His love is deep, and He forgives you, and He loves you, and that He is always knocking on the door of your heart, and He wants to come in and have fellowship with you. The old covenant was written by animal blood because it was a covenant of promise, but the new covenant is satisfied in the blood of Jesus Christ. So friends, let's examine our hearts this morning. Consider how we too have the heart of Judas, and every one of us in this room have that heart. Let's take a moment to examine ourselves before we participate in the communion. Judge ourselves, as the Bible says, and we will take communion.